Welcome to Larry King Live. Tonight, Nancy Reagan settles the score with friends and enemies from her extraordinary and tumultuous life as First Lady. Now, here's Larry King.
Our program tonight comes to you from New York City. We are having a horrendous day in New York, a terrible rainstorm. Traffic is unbelievable. Mrs. Reagan is here. We have also set up in a news. Normally, we don't work from the news set, but we are because they're fixing the other set, and we never like to lie to you. We have hooked up Nancy Reagan here tonight, and for the past 25 minutes, if we'd have taped that, we'd have had a burlesque scene. You're a real trooper to just be sitting here. In fact, there are electronic journalists now looking at this saying, how is she mic'd? How do we hear her?
And I'm not quite sure that I hope everybody does hear me. I've never been quite so hooked up before.
Yes, you are hooked up.
But I'll remember this always, Larry.
You're welcome. What about getting over here?
New York.
We think paths widen for the First Lady.
No. New York in the rain, and then you get in back of a chock-a-full nuts truck.
You're in back of the coffee people.
Yeah. And there you are. I mean, have you ever been in back of a chock-a-full nuts truck in the rain?
Never have been in back of a chock-full of nuts truck in the rain.
Well, it's an experience because you stay there for quite a long time.
Are you the kind who gets ticked at that? I don't handle it. Do you handle it?
I don't get ticked if I'm not supposed to be someplace. If I'm supposed to be someplace, visions of you all going in the air and not being able to go through all this that you went through. I mean, what would you have done?
That's right, nothing, Nancy, and this would have been embarrassing. But we got you here, and we got you all. In fact, there is no way you can get out of here.
It's true. I may be here forever.
In the history of guests, Nancy Reagan is trapped.
It's true.
Do you, as you look back, were you happy with all of this? I mean, early on, were you glad the way things started? Were you happy with First Ladydom? Did you like that scene? Going into the White House, the trappings, that whole beginning.
No, the whole beginning was very rough.
It should have been happy.
It should have been happy.
Your husband's elected president. You've been a First Lady in Sacramento.
Yeah.
That should have been great.
Yeah.
Why not?
But it wasn't. I'm not quite sure why it wasn't, but maybe I moved too quickly on redoing the White House and all of that. I thought the White House should be the best that there could be, you know. And until the shooting, I mean, that's all I was doing. And maybe if I'd waited longer, maybe if I'd known more about Washington. As I said to you earlier, I realized afterwards, just a few days ago, that Mrs. Carter and I were the only First Ladies who never knew Washington. Barbara Bush knows Washington like the back of her hand. Lady Bird, Pat Nixon, Jackie, they all had lived in Washington, knew the Hill, knew how it worked. And you have to know how Washington works. I knew nothing.
So you were kind of, do you blame yourself at all for that innocence?
Well,
should you
in
have
a way, I guess, I suppose. But how could I? I mean, I couldn't have known if I hadn't been there.
Oh, but how about your reaction to it when that initial criticism started?
Yes, I was partly to blame because it's my nature, I suppose. When somebody criticizes me or hones in on me, then I tend to pull back, and the curtain comes down, and it's self-protection, but and maybe, you know, it's self-defeating too.
Yeah, is this a lifelong thing? Have you always
done it? Always. Instead of striking back and getting angry, you know.
But the image of you is strike back. I mean, you title a book, My Turn. And that's not a laid-back title. That's not, here I am sitting in the corner with
the book. You learn after 8 years, as my mother said, and I say in the book, you play the hand that's dealt you. And that's the hand that's dealt me. And somewhere back in my background, it's funny, you know, you start thinking about things afterwards. I think back to my grandmother, who was a Southerner, but whose husband was transferred to the East. They had 9 children, mother was the youngest. But each child that she had, she moved back to the South to have that child because she wasn't gonna have any damn Yankee. And my mother was a very strong woman, wonderful, wonderful wonderful sense of humor, just a great woman.
Would you call yourself strong?
Now, I'm much stronger than I was when I went there, but I learned it.
Were you a strong woman before then?
Mm-mm.
Not?
Mm-mm. Easy? I was used to, you see, I when we were in pictures, all the publicity that I was ever used to was,
good.
Isn't it nice that wonderful, or isn't it wonderful that nice Ronald Reagan is going to marry that nice Nancy Davis? That's what I was used to.
And in Sacramento, things were easy too?
In the beginning, I had the same, oddly enough, the same thing with the house.
You were redoing the Capitol?
We moved out of the house. It was a fire hazard. Had been declared a fire hazard.
Did the press jump on you there, though?
They jumped on me there, but very quickly let off, because all the people understood. So that didn't last long.
Do you hold a bitterness toward Washington?
No.
The place?
No.
A lot of the people, though.
No, not a lot of the people.
Some of the people.
Some, maybe. I don't know whether bitter is the right word or not. I really don't believe it.
Why'd you write the book?
For my turn.
I mean, did you say to yourself, I am going to state this for the record, I'm going to come forth? Did you know that, like, when you left the presidency?
Yeah, because I'd been working on it for 3 years. It took me 3 years.
You wanted to write this book.
I wanted to write it. I wanted to give my side that I hadn't given in 8 years. I didn't think it was right I should. And 8 years is a long time to stay silent in the face of all the things that were being said.
Are you happy with it now, the way it
turned out? I'm happy with it if people will read the whole book. I'm not happy if they just take out the buzz points and string those all together. Then that doesn't give you a whole picture of me or my life. But if they read the whole book, then I think they'll understand.
There's a bigger story here happening. Nancy and I are just having a great time hooking her up. Our guest is Nancy Reagan. Her memoirs, My Turn, The Memoirs of Nancy Reagan, published by Random House, and of course to a great deal of attention. Okay, let's run down some of the things. We have obtained an advance copy of Donald Regan's review of your book, which will appear in the Washingtonian magazine in December. And here's what he says. You can comment. Your turn. She seems incapable of understanding how her words and deeds might seem selfish, hypocritical, and indeed even frightening to those on the outside.
That's his opinion. He had his turn. This is my turn. I'm not going to get into
it. Do you think it was a bad idea to have him review the book?
It wouldn't be something that I would have done.
He said time and again he's struck by the lack of gratitude expressed toward the people who helped you get to the White House and bring about the Reagan Revolution.
Oh.
Well, there's a thing we can talk about. Your feeling of gratitude toward those who helped.
Oh, no. Whoops. Something happened.
It can pop up.
Oh, okay. No, that's wrong. I was very, very grateful, and all those people know it.
Did you not like him from the start?
No, I didn't know him the first 4 years. He was in Treasury. I didn't know Don Regan, and wasn't until he came over to the White House that I got to know him.
And how would you describe it to someone, let's say, who didn't even know this situation? This was a case of what? Two people, they should have had a common interest, that common interest being the presidency. What went wrong?
Well, I don't think the common interest was the presidency, or was the president. Mine was the president. We had our first run-in when Ronnie was first operated on. And he wanted him to get out sooner than the doctors thought he should, or I thought he should. And we had a run-in then. And then it went kind of from bad to worse.
What's the role? Someone said in reviewing one of your books, should we have a first lady?
Yeah.
Should there be a first lady who has, I mean, where we go for her quotes or she's interviewed, or should we go back to the old days when the first lady was just someone?
But Larry, don't you think, I mean, every woman is entitled to her opinion and her right to give that opinion to anybody, particularly the man she's married to. I don't think, now he can either take it or leave it. There are many times Ronnie didn't take my advice or my opinion. Many times he didn't even ask for it.
But you always gave it.
I always gave it.
But do you think that we as a public, where we put our first ladies, the kind of pressure we put on them, I mean, they have to be performers, they have to be special, they have to be above the fray, they have to be near perfect, and if they're not, we're going to take off on them. You have no office, you have no voting power.
No.
We don't salary you.
No.
Why should there be a...
Always the problem of what to do with the boss's wife.
Ah, that's what it is.
Right?
And except we all pay the boss.
Yeah.
So we all employ him.
Yeah.
You're his wife.
Yeah, but there you are, and you're expected to do something. Now, I found something that I really wanted to do and was very interested in and did do, the drug program. So I did have that. You know, everybody's different, and...
Did you feel a responsibility to the public?
Oh, sure, you can't help but feel that. You can't help.
Yes, you definitely felt that you owed the public something.
Yes, yes. In that position, yes.
In writing honestly about your family, was that difficult?
Very.
To write honestly about estrangement?
Very.
Patty was on this show, and she didn't want to talk about it. Mm. But she did answer one question. She said she had some friends who are close to their parents, and she felt sad because she wished she had that. She wished there weren't an estrangement.
I wish there weren't an estrangement. She was, I think there's a little bit of selective memory there. And we've talked about, we have films of when the children were growing up, and it was a close family. Someday, I hope, we'll run those for her, and maybe she'll remember a lot of times.
She's the one that said goodbye, are you saying?
Mm-hmm.
Was that hard to write about?
Very.
Do you think you might get back?
Oh, I hope
so. I mean, that must be the saddest
thing. Yes, it is. We've seen her, and we've called and had her and her husband over, and...
You mean like recently?
Yes, mm-hmm, since we've been back.
Well, from Tokyo?
Yes.
So what happened? I mean, the public thinks about this. Is this encouraging? I mean, might we see a...
I don't know. We'll have to wait and see. It takes two to tango.
What was the dinner like?
It wasn't dinner.
Was it a meeting?
It was just coming over to see us in the afternoon. And I always said to them, to her particularly, because Patty's a very bright girl, always was. Attractive, could do much, much more than I could do. But I always said to her, don't be an if-only child. That must be terrible to live with. If only, after I'm 6 feet under, then to say, if only I'd said such and such, if only I'd done such and such. That's an awful, awful thing to have to live with. I was terribly close to my mother. And when my mother died, I mean, there isn't a day that passes that I don't think of my mother. And
so
I certainly
wasn't
a
nipple. So you want that with your
daughter, don't you? Yeah, and I want it for her, too.
Yeah.
I don't want her to have to live with that. That's...
So at this stage, though, forget political differences.
Oh, yeah.
You're a mother and a daughter.
Yeah.
I'm trying to fathom this as a parent.
It's very painful.
Couldn't you just...
I've tried.
Hug and...
I've tried.
We've talked about Patty. Was it tough to marry someone with two children?
Very.
And a famous mother.
Very, very. And you have to think back to those days, how long ago that was, when...
We're talking about early 50s, late 40s.
Yes, huh? Yes. When divorce was not all that common, and Ronnie was brought up with the idea that you only married once, and that was it.
Oh.
But even though I got to know them very well before we were married, even so. It's
hard. Step-parenting at best.
It's hard. And then when you get married and you have your own children, that's twice as hard.
You are close now with Maureen, Michael, and Ronnie.
Yeah, very. We have a wonderful relationship, all of them.
Would it have been better if you and Jane Wyman, in reading the book, were surprised that you didn't talk more? It's a good idea in...
I'm sure, oh yes, of course it would have. In those days, Ronnie had nothing to go by. You know, he didn't know anybody who'd been in this position. He didn't know how to act. I didn't know how to act. She was a big star, and that was a little intimidating to me. And
so you never had a conversation with her about how Maureen was acting or what Michael might be doing?
No, I had a couple of conversations, but we were never, you know, I never felt I could pick up the phone and call her, which is too bad.
What advice would you give to step-parents now, someone entering into this? Would you be more bold? Would you take the move more?
Well, I think now it's accepted that you do that. I mean, I think people just do it now. They didn't then.
We are going to include phone calls for Nancy Reagan tonight. We'll be going to them in just a moment. I do want to cover some other bases, and then we'll take your calls. The book is My Turn. You and Raisa, overblown?
Yes, yes.
How did that start?
I mean, you know... There was too much attention paid on what she wore, what I wore. Who cared? That wasn't the important part. The important part was what those two men were doing. That was the important part. And there were some, we did have some moments there. But it softened at the end.
You like her?
At the end, I think, in the book, I say that she said it was destiny that put us at the size of our husband at a time when our countries were coming closer together. And I hope that I'll see you again. I hope you'll come to Russia. And I said, and I hope you'll come to California. And I meant it.
That was a remarkable thing, that whole thing, Gorbachev, isn't it?
Yes.
I mean, you lived a part of it.
Yes.
Changing the world, watching what's going on now.
Yes, well, yes, because it paved the way for what's going on now, I believe.
Any thoughts on the Kitty Dukakis story today?
Oh, that's sad. That's so sad. I feel so bad.
You had written her.
I'd written her when she first came out and said this was a problem with her. And I had a very nice letter back from her. But I felt so badly about this, and I hope
Kitty, for the benefit of you don't know, Kitty Dukakis is in a hospital in Boston, apparently has taken in ingested rubbing alcohol, and we can only hope that... Not easy being in that limelight,
is it? No, it's not. No, it's not. And you know, when you leave the White House, we left... 8 years is a very long time to be there, but we left under the best of circumstances. But to leave there in defeat, oh boy, that must be terrible. And to have your husband defeated must be awful.
Yeah, you never saw that, did you? Well, you did it at a convention.
Yeah, but you see, we felt the emotion of the convention was so loving that I didn't get the feel that you usually get.
Let's include some calls for Nancy Reagan. We'll start with Washington, D.C. Hello.
I'd like to say that I think that you and your husband represented the United States very, very well and made us all proud to be Americans. And that leads me to my question. I'd like to know what you thought about Oliver North, and did you think that he should have been pardoned, and what your advice to your husband was with that regard?
Oh, I stayed out of that as regards advising my husband. I didn't like the things that he said about his relationship with my husband, which was no relationship. Other than that, I'm not going to get into legal questions about
Oliver. They had no relationship.
No.
Detroit for Nancy Reagan. Hello.
Hi, Larry. Hi, Mrs. Reagan.
Hi.
Hi. Nancy, I was wondering if you ever thought of going back into the movies. Are you, please?
Would you do a film again?
I hadn't really thought about
it. Just look at here tonight. This is show business.
Yes.
You're here to last time.
Yes. Do you think it would always be like this?
I never thought I would come this close to a first lady. No, would you do a part?
I don't know. I never thought about that.
Your husband's been offered roles, right?
Yes, they've talked to him about it. And once in a while, they'll kiddingly say something to me about it. And I always say, put it on the back burner.
Well, let's put it on the front burner, would you?
I don't know. No, I'm not saying no. I guess it would depend on the picture. Now that there are more family type pictures coming back.
I mean, you must miss it. That's something you gotta miss. That's fun.
That was fun. It was fun. Yeah, it was. And it certainly was a large part of my life.
So the right role, you would consider it. Why not?
Maybe.
You're still living. You're not retired, are you?
No.
How are we gonna break it to them?
I don't know.
Ronnie won't believe it.
No.
Julie won't buy it. Something's going on here. Anyway, never mind. Before we, it's really weird. Before we get back to our next call for Nancy, the astrology thing.
Yeah.
What's it all about, Alfie?
You have to have gone through a shooting, which is.
By the way, brilliantly described in the book. It's one of the best first chapters you'll ever read, that shooting. I must say that.
Well, that's something that is different from cancer, anything else. It's something that you can't describe it. It just stays with you, and you're scared to death, and he was so close to death, which I don't think anybody at the time knew. I don't think anybody now knows. I mean, there were two times that they came to me and said they couldn't find his pulse. And that he was so close to going into shock. And if he had, that would have been it. Not everybody has their way of handling those kind of situations. And you really shouldn't criticize people for how they handle anything to get through, particularly that kind of a situation.
And astrology helped you?
It was one of the things that helped me. Religion helped me. My friends helped me.
Well, but the belief is that we are affected by our birth. In other words, you would use. I'm asking
well,
this
I'm,
as a question.
Well, I mean, a friend of mine called and said that this lady had called him and said, "Gee, if I'd only known, I could have told her that she shouldn't have done anything that day." And I thought, "Oh my Lord, I could have prevented it." So
you pay attention, or that's
so,
you include
well, I did
that in your
at the
living.
Time, yes.
Do you still?
No.
Because of all that's happened since?
No, I just I never had before.
Joan Quigley, the astrologer, is writing a book about all of this. Obviously, getting some fame from it. Yeah. How do you react to that?
Well, everybody can write a book, I suppose, if they want to.
I mean, does it anger you? Sadden you?
I think it's too bad that she's doing it.
Is she a good astrologer?
Well, Ronnie's still here.
Largo, Florida for Nancy Reagan. Hello.
Hello, how are you?
Hi.
Good evening, Mrs. Reagan.
Hi.
Listen, I've seen you, Mrs. Reagan, on television doing one of those information commercials endorsing a line of bee pollen. Do you really use bee pollen? Are you going to be doing other commercials?
I've never seen those commercials.
What are you talking about, sir?
A television program on the air called In Search of the Fountain of Youth, and it shows Mr. and Mrs. Reagan on the program endorsing a particular brand of bee pollen.
You sure about your facts, sir?
Oh, I'm absolutely positive.
You know, that may be, somebody wrote me and said that they saw a commercial and that they used our names and pictures incorrectly because we never made a commercial.
Does on the commercial, sir, does Mrs. Reagan speak about the product?
No, they do not. Mr. and Mrs. They show the commercial shows letters written by Mr. and Mrs. Reagan, President Mrs. Reagan, to the company endorsing this particular brand, and also an article that appeared in Parade magazine endorsing it by brand. And I was just wondering if that's accurate. Are they bee pollen users, and are they going to be doing other commercials?
No.
You're not bee pollen users?
No. I tell you, I think maybe what this all grew out of was that I don't even remember the name of the company now, but they sent us some bars for Quick Energy that had bee pollen in them. And nobody else liked them, but Ronnie and I loved them, so we ate them. That was the extent of it.
You didn't write them a letter or anything?
No. Well, we may have written them a letter to thank them for sending them to us. but we did not do any commercials.
You should certainly look into if they're using your name.
Yes, as a matter of fact, I think we did, now that I'm remembering. I think we did.
So you're not endorsing that product?
No.
With Nancy Reagan, we go to Boston. Hello. Austin, Texas. Hello.
Hello.
Yes.
Yes. Do you and your husband still deny that women and children are homeless and live below the poverty line because of the policies of your husband, since he never submitted a balanced budget and slashed the programs designed to help them, or as he claims, because they prefer to live on grates?
Hold on. Your husband and the poor. I guess that was the general question.
Well, I don't think the lady understands my husband's positions or what he did. Or what he believes.
Let me tell you something surprising about your book. You were a moderating influence in that White House. We, the general public, had the image of you as much more right-wing, maybe based on the fact that your father was very conservative.
Yeah, but he was not as conservative as most people. Most people said that he was a rich...
John Birch,
yes. Yeah, and he never... As a matter of fact, he really wasn't particularly interested in politics.
He wasn't.
No.
And you were... I would have to call you a moderate. You were a moderating influence. You were pro a nuclear arms treaty. You were tended to place down when the far right got wild inside that White House. You were the one that sort of put a damper on that. How did we get the wrong image of you?
I don't know. I wish there were things that I don't know how so many wrong images came. I don't know.
And we've never heard you on there's going to be a big march Sunday in Washington for, and it was a major issue in the campaigns yesterday about women's right to choose.
And I'm not going to tell you now how I feel, Larry.
But you seem like you would stand for women's choice. I mean, I'm just saying this as the kind of person I've gotten to know.
I know.
You look like that you would say, don't you tell me what to do with my body.
Mm. Shall we move on?
But you're not saying the other either.
I'm not saying anything.
You're not saying either either.
Either.
Okay, no
either
comment.
Either.
You say. New York City for Nancy Reagan. Hello.
Hello. Larry, love your show.
Thank you.
Nancy, you've never looked better.
Thank you.
Would you comment on the late Abby Hoffman statement that to tell a drug addict to just say no is like telling a manic depressive to just cheer up? And secondly, if you would.
Okay, we lost you there, but that's a fair question. Good question.
Yeah, it is. And I've heard that said, that it, just say no is a very shallow way of treating the whole drug problem. And of course it is. Just Say No came into existence because I answered a little girl's question in Oakland when she said, Mrs. Reagan, what do you do when somebody asks you to take drugs? And I said, you just say no. Somehow this caught on and it became part of our vocabulary. Actually, it was good because it was kind of a rallying point.
And we thought about it.
But
you were never saying just say no would work.
No. I'm a big believer that it starts with education. You start teaching them when you teach them to read and write. That's when you start teaching them about drugs. And we have made progress at that level, at the younger level. We have made progress. These kids know more about drugs than, you know, a lot of the older ones.
Are you optimistic about that problem?
You have to be optimistic. If you don't, it's a self-fulfilling prophecy, I think.
By the way, the LA, we're going to get to the next call. The LA Times said your book could have been called Getting Even.
No.
You don't feel that way? You don't feel it was?
No. I didn't want, it wasn't to get even. It was just to have my turn.
Have you read the reviews? Do you sit and read the reviews of the book?
Unfortunately, some I have, yes.
Gets you your dander up?
Well, I don't think they're, I think that most of them have done exactly what I said that I hope people don't do. They've taken the buzz points and strung them all together, and I don't think that gives a complete picture of what
Washington Post
like.
Was a little rough on it.
Yes.
Did that hurt you?
Mm-hmm.
Sally Quinn wrote that.
Yeah, that was not... I'm not the top of her hit parade.
But you're friends with the publisher of that paper.
Yes.
You and Catherine Graham hit
it
off right away.
Right away.
That was one of your first friends in Washington, right?
But long before I got to Washington.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. We knew each other when Ronnie was governor.
Back to the calls. Chicago for Nancy Reagan. Hello.
Mrs. Reagan, I have a statement and I want to know if you agree with me and if you would agree with me. When you read all those negative things, and there's been a lot of negative things about the trip to Japan and everything else in the paper lately. Do you ever feel as if it's more or less of a vendetta by the press? Because the voters would never believe what the press was trying to make them believe. We would never believe it, yet they're still trying to perpetuate it.
Well, gee, I hope you don't believe it. Just keep on not believing it, that's all.
But though people have a right to be surprised at that kind of speaking fee, don't you? I mean, that was a lot of money for two speeches.
We get, but you see, you're all wrong, Larry.
Help me, Nancy.
Gave much more than two speeches. They never said anything about what I did. I helped them set up a whole drug program. I met with business people on the drug problem. I gave speeches on the drug problem. He met with a lot of business people. They adore him over there because they're very aware that he was the one who started a better relationship between the two countries.
Why do you think there was such anger over it, though?
I don't know.
Because of the
price. I mean, there are people who get he could have gotten more money if he'd done a picture.
More money
right?
To do a movie.
Sure.
Butler, Pennsylvania, for Nancy Reagan. Hello.
Hi, Larry.
Hi.
Mrs. Reagan.
Yes.
I want to tell you that I was not a real Ronald Reagan fan, but I also want to tell you that I think you're the biggest supporter of your husband that I've ever seen, and I hope I can be just as good in case my husband's ever been in trouble.
Thank you.
Thank you, I think.
Thank you, I think, yes.
What's the question?
My question is, please tell me there is a redeeming quality about Imelda Marcos. I have a poster of her on my wall at work that we all laugh about, and I want to know that there's something that got this woman and her husband into power.
Anything you liked about Imelda?
Well, I don't really, I mean...
Did you know her well?
No, I didn't know her that well. She was always very nice. The Secret Service told me that when they were guarding them in Hawaii, that she was always very kind to them, would take them food, would care about them, and mm-hmm. and so on.
But you didn't know her that well.
So I'm really.
How do you explain this? Your love affair with your husband that has lasted with the intensity apparently it has lasted for all these years. I mean,
almost 38 years.
Yeah, and you're kind of madly in love with each other, right?
Yeah.
I mean, it is a love affair.
Yeah.
You miss him now, right? He
I
won't
do.
Be here. He'll be here what?
Saturday.
Friday or Saturday? Is there an explanation for that, or is it just is?
Well, congratulations, by the way.
Thank you.
To you. Well, I think part of it is that he had been married before. He was very cautious, obviously, and naturally. And I was a child of divorce. I didn't want to make a mistake. And we were both, although I was I knew a little bit sooner than he did. And I don't know, it doesn't happen.
But the intensity has lasted, hasn't it?
Yes.
To right now, today, is like 20 years ago.
Yes.
To Buffalo, New York, for Nancy Reagan. Hello.
Good evening, Larry. Nancy, you're looking just wonderful.
Thank you.
Just wondered if you'd be kind enough to tell me if you had any very special experience or memory during your years in the White House.
Oh.
A special moment? There must have been tons.
Oh, so lots. Oh, so lots. So many. There was when I spoke to the United Nations. I mean, I never thought I'd ever be speaking to the United Nations.
I thought the day you left was very poignant. You
yes,
write about that,
that was,
very
yes,
poignant.
That was
hard
that
place to leave, isn't it?
Wrenching.
That ain't a bad place. I like the line about the electrician was late.
If you need a plumber, you can get a plumber.
If you need one, you get one.
Yeah.
Thumbnail sketches. Jim Baker, you said he was the one that leaked a lot to the press.
Well, but a lot did, and they always say that, but they don't say what else I said about Jim. That Jim was very helpful to Ronnie, helped get a lot of his programs through.
Best chief of staff he had.
That whole troika, which everybody made fun of in the beginning, but turned out to work very well.
Question: why Maureen Reagan's picture isn't in the book?
That was a mistake. It was. And supposed to be in the book, as was my brother's. My brother's picture wasn't
in the
book.
Yeah.
And I called them. They'd cut out a lot of pictures at the last minute. There'd been a snafu on the publishing of the book, and they had to get it out in a hurry. And they cut out a lot of pictures.
Will they add them in
if
the paper
bag? If there is a second printing, there will be a picture of Maureen as there was supposed to be.
With Nancy Reagan, Liberty City, Florida. Hello.
Yes, Ms. Reagan.
Hi.
Let me ask you this. Well, first of all, I want to say real quick that I like Ron's hair like that. It's a good look for him.
Okay.
I want to ask you this. The phone calls back and forth to Joan Quigley. Now, like, who paid for those? Did the American taxpayers pay for them phone calls?
I paid for those.
That's broken down in the book. You have a certain amount of living expense and then you pay.
I pay, yeah. You pay, really, the first family pays for a lot of things that the public doesn't understand or know about. Food, toiletries, cleaning, you know.
Do you hate having people, not hate is a bad word. You went to the ladies' room before we came in here tonight.
Yeah.
Four guys walked you up to the door on the way outside. That would drive me a little berserko. I mean, that would be berserko. I know you're used to it.
Yeah, you're used to it, and I think about it differently than most people because of the shooting. Without them, I wouldn't have a husband.
So you're glad they're there.
So I'm glad.
You're glad they're out here tonight. Yeah. You're glad they're with Ronnie tonight.
Yeah, I certainly am.
St. Petersburg, Florida, for Nancy Reagan. Hello.
Good evening, Mrs. Reagan.
Hi.
I have one question for you briefly. Why did you just say no to the drug rehab facility they were going to build near your home if you are so sincere about the drug program?
Because I had no idea. It wasn't that near my home, but it was in Los Angeles. Because I had no idea that the people in that area really, really didn't want us there. Really didn't want us there. To the point that they were going to demonstrate in front of the house, which really wasn't the main thing, although I don't think the neighbors would have been pleased about it. But so I decided it wasn't worth it. I have a foundation. I'm very active in that. I've given away 3 grants already. I will give away more.
Do you think less of them for not wanting it?
Well, it's I don't understand it. I don't understand it. There was a place near our ranch where they had a place for kids with cancer, and they couldn't get the place because the people objected to it. And I just, you know,
bizarre.
Yeah, I don't understand that.
With Nancy Reagan, New York City. Hello.
Yes, I'm a person with AIDS, and I want to know. I know that Mrs. Reagan has friends and associates who have died of the disease, and many PWAs find it hard to forgive the fact that Mr. Reagan, made no mention of AIDS for so long. Did you encourage him to speak out, and if not, why not?
Oh no, he appointed a commission early on to try to find out about AIDS. As a matter of fact, my brother was involved in appointing that commission. I don't think for a while. I'm sure you must know this. I don't think for a while that people knew how serious it was. And it certainly is a serious thing, tied into drugs, you know, it's.
Hmm. How long have you had it, sir?
5 years.
Well, the prognosis is what?
I have Kaposi sarcoma. I've had it for 2 years. Started with ARC 5 years ago.
You've had friends die of it, right?
Oh, yes. Yes, haven't you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Every guest we've had on, Rock Hudson was a
friend. Rock Hudson, yeah. Never knew.
Thank you, sir. You never knew he had it?
I never knew.
Did you talk to him at all?
Yes, he was at the White House for dinner, and I thought he was thin. And I commented on it, and he said, well, I lost weight. I was doing a picture in Germany, and I lost weight. And I thought that was so.
Thank you, Nancy.
Thank you, Larry.